When he says, "Go ahead, make my day," millions of fans laugh and cheer at the same time. But why are they so fascinated by Dirty Harry Callahan, the most famous cop in the movies today? Clint Eastwood has made 4 Dirty Harry movies, and the latest one, Sudden Impact, is the biggest box office hit of all. Why is Dirty Harry so popular? We'll try and answer that question and analyze some key scenes from all 4 Dirty Harry movies on a special program, The Secret of Dirty Harry. That's this week at the movies, the movie review program. Dirty Harry Callahan and The Secret of Dirty Harry, this week at the movies, the movie review program.
Hottest video movie rentals this week? Well, I've been receiving lots of requests for terms of endearment.
Why should I? Why should I be happy about being a grandmother?
I came here to rent my favorite movie, Clint Eastwood in Sudden Impact.
Go ahead. Make my day.
I've been looking all over for this movie, and I finally found it. The right stuff.
We'll load right all the way. Good speed, young man.
That's what's renting at video stores across the nation, and this special edition of At the Movies is our guide to what we think of the top 10 movies in cassette rentals. Across the aisle from me, Roger Ebert, film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And across the aisle from me is Gene Siskel, film critic of the Chicago Tribune. On today's program, I think we're going to discover some interesting things about people who rent video cassettes and about the cassettes that they're renting. Now that nearly 10 million families own cassette machines, they're more than just electronic toys. They represent, for the movie industry, about 25% of a hit movie's total revenue. And what they may be doing is recapturing the adult audience for Hollywood, recapturing the people over 30 who rarely go out to a movie theater, but they're getting interested now in the movies again because of cassettes at home. And as we count down the current top 10 most rented cassettes, I think we're going to see a pattern. These aren't the teenage movies that make millions in movie theaters that are renting to the folks at home. They're mostly more serious, more mature films, movies for grown-ups.
We're using Billboard magazine as our source, and number 10 on the list is Educate and Rita, and that certainly was a film that appealed much more to older moviegoers than young ones. It's sort of an adult fairy tale about a prince transforming a frog and being transformed himself. Michael Caine plays a down-at-the-heels literature professor who teaches a Cockney hairdresser about poetry, and she winds up teaching him about the will to live and create. Neither one of us recommended this film when it first came out. We thought it was too predictable. We still do, don't we? Okay. Number 9, Clint Eastwood's 4th Dirty Harry film, Sudden Impact, with Harry chasing a vigilante who is killing rapists. This film is no surprise on the list. It is a big hit with kids and with adults because of the Dirty Harry character taking control of situations like this.
What you doing, pinkhead sucker?
You boys put those guns down.
Say what?
We're not just gonna let you walk out of here.
Who is we, sucker?
Smith, and Wesson, and me. Go ahead. Make my day.
I think that one line helped make the box office for that picture. I didn't like Sudden Impact because I didn't think he had a tough enough villain to be battling in this story. But adult audiences seem to enjoy most anything Clint Eastwood does in this role of Dirty Harry, because I think the last three haven't been all that great. I'm sure the series will continue, and I hope the next time he does square off against someone or a group tougher than this villain in this picture.
Well, I liked Sudden Impact more than you did, but I think it's interesting that of these first three pictures we've looked at, a movie like Educating Rita was soft at the box office. It didn't get that key audience for movie theaters of 16 to 25, and yet adults are interested in it. It makes them think. It gives them some adult characters they can identify with, and so they're bringing it home, and the word of mouth that didn't get them into theaters is getting them into the rental stores.
What I've heard is that the people who buy cassettes, you know, the $40 or more for cassettes, that mirrors more closely the younger audience.
Those are the kids.
Isn't that interesting? Because who else would be foolish enough to spend that kind of money?
They want to see Raiders of the Lost Ark 117 times, right? The adults are happy, just see it once.
But adults won't spend that kind of money. They're too, you know, mature about money. Kids, let it ride.
Okay, but for $3 you can rent, right? Yeah. Continuing on the list, number 8 is Gorky Park, which was also another movie that was soft at the box office, but it's a hit on cassette. It was a thoughtful, cerebral thriller about a series of vicious murders in a city park in the middle of Moscow, and it starred William Hurt as the Russian cop on the trail of the murderer, and in this scene, he questions a mysterious American fur trader played by Lee Marvin.
What are we talking about?
Dead bodies in Gorky Park. Doesn't it interest you?
Me?
I have established that you knew all three of them.
Have you now? Well, I met Stalin when I was young. Did you know that? No. Well, you do know that Stalin is dead. Now, does the mere fact that I met him prove that I killed him?
The sadists cut off their faces.
Do you mind?
In the same way he might skin an animal. A sable, perhaps.
Gorky Park was, of course, the number one best-selling book, but who buys books? Not teenagers. And the adults who had read the book, or maybe who at least bought it and put it on their shelf and meant to read it, well, they waited for the cassette to be released in order to see the movie. So here it is, number 8 on the best-selling rental list, even though way down in the middle when it came to box office performance.
You know, you mentioned $3. When I rent infrequently, it's $4, and that might be a key thing going on here, which is there might be in people's mind it's not worth $5 or $10 for a couple or $15 for a couple and a child, but it is worth $3 or $4.
I don't think there's any doubt about it. I saw in my neighborhood two rentals for $5 the other day, and how many people can you jam into that family room and you get to talk back at the screen and spill beer all over your wife, and it's just a really great time, even if the movie's no good.
And don't count this out. On special effects films, which are not on this list, and that is significant, but also, I think, and this is why they want to own them, is the playback, the slow-mo. I've done it mine once in a while to slow it down and see the effect. How do they actually do that? So that's part of the appeal. Coming up next at the movies, an ultra-violent modern-day gangster picture.
Fresh Start got straight A's on all these stains after Kenilworth's school outing. We took on Victor's chocolate milk, the ketchup Tammy and Leah shared, Charles and Sergio's ground in dirt. Nothing gets out every stain, but Fresh Start is super concentrated with extra stain fighters. So one little bottle cleaned all 128 of them and got straight A's on their chocolate milk, ketchup, ground in dirt. And on all these stains, Fresh Start is the straight A detergent.
The trouble with the average bargain trash bag is that what goes in doesn't always stay in. Now this is the Glad 3-Ply Trash Bag, the strong Glad 3-Ply Trash Bag, made of Stress Flex plastic. So advanced, so strong, it really fights punctures, because it stretches and stretches instead of breaking. The Glad 3-Ply, made of Stress Flex. After all, what goes in ought to stay in.
Okay, what's so great about summer?
It's hot, she's nasty, definitely don't be those. Don't be those Doritos. Move fast, act fast,
nacho cheese Doritos brand tortilla chips.
Definitely.
I used to spend a fortune dry cleaning my clothes until I realized I can trust Woolite for all my fine washables.
For pennies a capful, Woolite cleans my quilted jacket or pleated skirt, even my best silk blouse. In fact, this whole bottle of Woolite can cost a lot less than dry cleaning this blouse just once.
Just a capful keeps the look and feel you love.
I trust Woolite.
Continuing with our top 10 rental movie cassettes is All the Right Moves in the number 7 slot, featuring Tom Cruise as a high school football player trying to make it out of his working class home. This is only one of two teen-oriented films on the list. Roger liked the film a lot. I disagree. I think it's a routine melodrama, although Tom Cruise is a good young actor, and the film does have a nice sense of the working class life. Number 6, Uncommon Valor, with Gene Hackman as a retired Vietnam colonel returning to Southeast Asia to bring back soldiers still missing in action, including his son. This is certainly a film that had an adult audience appeal. In fact, part of the appeal was Vietnam veterans themselves now in their 30s and 40s. I found the film to be a routine ripoff of The Dirty Dozen. Roger agreed, but this film was a surprise hit. Many older action fans really enjoyed this as a way of seeing America win a Vietnam War, even if it was on film. Number 5 is Christine, Stephen King thriller about a jealous killer car, the other teen-oriented film on the list. Both Roger and I thought this was a charming idea, well told, very funny, exciting, escapist entertainment. Number 4 on the current Billboard list of video cassette rentals, Scarface, Brian De Palma's updating of the gangster classic, this time telling the story of an immigrant played by Al Pacino who comes to the United States as a hoodlum and rises to the top of the cocaine-dealing world only to be gunned down at the end. Along the way, this Tony Montana character tries to protect his sister from imitating his lifestyle. In one of the film's few good scenes, at least as far as I'm concerned, he roughs her up when he sees her using cocaine.
This is my private room. This is my private room, huh? I've got a beautiful nice white lounge chair for you, huh?
Tony! What are you doing? What are you doing?
What the hell, man? We won't do nothing in there!
Get out of here!
Get out of here! Get out of here!
What do you think? It's you? Yeah. Saw somebody putting his hand all over your ass? My kid's sister? In the toilet?
You can't tell me what to do!
I'm telling you what to do! Listen to me. Listen to me. Come here. I got you here again. Mm-hmm. Did you hear me? I got you here again. I'm going to wipe you all over the place.
Oh, yeah. Understand? Yeah, go ahead. Do it now. I want to see it. I want to see it now, big
don't
shot.
Push me, baby.
No, I want to know. Shut up. Come on. Wait.
Come on.
Come on. Stop. You got some nerve, Tony. You think you can come in here now and tell me what to do?
Get out of here.
You can't tell me what to do, Tony. No more. I am not a baby anymore. I'll do what I want to do. I'll see whoever I want to see.
Come on, man.
I thought Pacino's accent was too broad in the film. I thought he overacted in this movie. I thought that the film itself was pretty much worthless because it told the story not of the fall of a great man or even an average man, but the fall of a louse about whom I cared not a bit. I also think the film is phony as some kind of anti-drug statement. It's much too romantic a portrait of the drug world. I wouldn't rent this for free.
Romantic a portrait of the drug world?
Too romantic, yeah.
That's an interesting criticism. I think I've never heard that before. But anyway, leaving the movie aside, as a film, despite the fact that I liked it very much, but leaving aside that point, the fact that adults are renting it is interesting because it's longer than 2 hours. This is It's a 2 hour and, what is it, about 25, 30 minute movie. It's the story of a man's life from the beginning through the middle to the end with a structure to it. And if I may say so, and I dare do say so, teenagers are more interested in films that are happening at every single instant. Mm-hmm. There has to be sound and light and motion and action and music coming at them in a Star Wars or a music video sense, instead of the old kind of old-fashioned Hollywood formula of a well-made story from beginning to end of a man's life. That's why I think it appeals more to older viewers.
I think also this is a probably a weekend kind of entertainment. There's something spicy about this film, and I think it's a, you know, a weekend entertainment picture more than one that you'd watch during the week. That's about all I can come up with. I wouldn't rent it for free.
Well, I would rent it for $3. How's that? The number three most rented cassette in the country right now is Silkwood, another thoughtful adult movie about real-life problems. It starred Meryl Streep as a nuclear plant worker who didn't like working conditions at the factory where she was working, and she made a protest that may have cost her her life. Gene and I both really admired this movie, which was not only about a real-life case that came out of the headlines, but was also about real lives in Oklahoma and about adults who were having problems with children from earlier marriages, with love affairs, with trying to grow up and adjust to the facts of life and to their lives. And it's a movie that adults really are interested in.
This is the one, I think, more like your Scarface review, where I think really this would have an appeal to adults as a full, rich story. I don't know if kids would enjoy it very much.
Next at the movies, a real surprise. The box office flop named The Right Stuff has taken off as a cassette and rocketed all the way to number two on the charts.
Good Lord, right all the way. Godspeed, John Glenn.
Number two on the list of the nation's most rented video cassettes right now is a real surprise, an enormous hit in rental, an enormous disaster, comparatively speaking in terms of its budget, at the box office. The movie is The Right Stuff, the story of America's space program, from the first jet test pilots to the Mercury astronauts. The Right Stuff was a wonderful movie. It was intelligent and original, and in fact, Gene and I both picked it as the best film of 1983.
Terrific.
We talked about it about three times on this program, and millions of people listened to us and decided not to go see The Right Stuff. It was a real disappointment at the box office, and teenagers in particular stayed away by the millions. But what about the adults who had lived through the early years of the space age? Well, they could actually remember moments like the ones in this scene, which shows Gordon Cooper's Earth orbital mission.
I'm ready when you are, John. 100%.
Okay.
T-minus 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
sun is coming through the window now.
Oh, Lord, what a heavenly light.
You know, Gene, just looking at that scene again, what a good movie this is, and how absolutely convincing that launch looked. It looked like a real 1963 event.
You know, I almost want to say, I don't care whether people see it on rentals, in a little screen or a big screen, although really, I do want to have people see it on a big screen. Mm-hmm. This is a big-scale, ambitious film. They should see it in a big theater.
It's one of the most, you're right, it's one of the most ambitious, original, inventive American movies of the last, since The Godfather, I'd say, in terms of the ambition it has about dealing with American history and with a part of the American character. Boy, it's good. And if you were around in 1963, that scene, I think, probably had a familiar ring for you. But that would mean that today, you're probably in your mid-30s or even older. Goodness gracious. Not part of the movie theater target audience of 16 to 25. And so The Right Stuff just didn't have it at the American box office. There weren't enough customers to inspire the word-of-mouth advertising that it needed. But now, older moviegoers are discovering this movie on cassette, a movie that means a lot to them, so that The Right Stuff, which was a flop, is now outrunning Dirty Harry, Christine, Scarface.
Yeah. Some of it may have to do with the timing of when these films are released, and that always affects the ranking on a box office or a rental list that we're talking about. But still, the fact that it's number two at all, any week, even the first week that it's available, is impressive, and I'm glad to see it. I think it's a marvelous film. This would be one that I'd buy. This is worth the money.
I think I'd buy this one, too. Yeah. 40, 50, 60. I'd even pay $79.50 for it, which I think is what it's selling for.
I think that may show up as an ad someplace. Coming up next at the movies, the number one most frequently rented movie on cassette.
Do you need some help?
No, I'll be fine just as soon as I stretch my legs.
Hidden Valley Ranch in a bottle?
Oh, it is. Delicious. After all these years.
Special. Wow! Look how thick it is.
I pronounce it uniquely delicious.
The unique Hidden Valley Ranch blend of buttermilk herbs and spices in a bottle.
They couldn't.
They did.
My favorite.
At last, Hidden Valley Ranch in a bottle.
At last, Hidden Valley Ranch in a bottle.
And now a little drum roll, please. Number one, it's Terms of Endearment. Everybody likes this picture. And thinking about this film, so much has been said that the only new insight I can offer now is that I am really still impressed by the quality control in this film. There isn't a bad moment in it. There isn't an awkward speech. There isn't an actor falling out of character. And despite the intense, dramatic shifts this movie makes at the end, swinging from high comedy to high drama, we do believe that Terms of Endearment approximates life, real life, closely observed and compressed. A favorite scene of mine, and its lifelike quality, is the moment Deborah Winger and her husband and her children leave her mother, and there's a tearful goodbye.
Okay, fingers and toes in. Take Mama's purse.
Mm.
Mama, that's the first time I stopped hugging first. I like that.
Get yourself a decent maternity dress.
You had to get one in, didn't you?
Oh, good for you. Did you tell her, Patsy? She keeps thinking it's me when I say those things. Tom? Are you going to be good to your mother and take care of her?
Bye, Mrs. Greenway.
Goodbye. Listen, you write as soon as you get there, so I'll have your address and all, okay? Shape up, Patsy.
Look, got my dog.
No, we'll get it.
Oh, we'll get you another piece, sweetheart.
The phone bill is going to be enormous, you know that.
I'll miss you, Mom.
Can we go now?
Yeah. Pull away slow.
I like everything about that scene. The fingers and toes, who's hugging whom longer. That pull-away shot, very nice. That's a very tricky relationship, too, between Deborah Winger and Shirley MacLaine. You can't write it in a sentence. And each of the characters in this film has his or her separate life away from their relationships, away from the other people in this film. Each one counts. If Terms of Endearment had been made as a television show, and I'm glad it wasn't, each one of the characters would probably have their own spin-off series by now. They're that strong as individuals.
I agree. It's a great movie, and it's a number one, as you said. But now, looking back over all of these movies and talking about video cassettes, there are a couple of statistics that I think are interesting. Mm-hmm. 10 million people own cassette recorders now, and yet the cassettes represent 25% of the income of a hit movie like one of these. Mm-hmm. What's going to happen when 20 million, 30 million people own video cassettes? Well, right now, despite the video cassettes that are already out there, the American movie business is looking at its first $4 billion year. 1984 is going to be the best year in its history. Starts for next year of new movies up 40%. Mm-hmm. It looks to me like the cassettes are actually helping the movie business and helping the entire business of making films. It's as if the cassettes are a weapon that Hollywood is using to recapture its traditional mass adult audience, along with the kids, of course.
Certainly financial, it's a tremendous help. What I hope doesn't happen is, I know you share this, is that we don't want to see the small screen become the primary viewing vehicle for pictures. It has to be the big screen, because if it doesn't happen, if people start to only see, I'll wait at home, then you'll never see the right stuff made. They'll never make a big screen epic. They'll make these intense personal dramas, which don't suffer as much, like Terms of Endearment, when you see them on a small screen.
That's
probably right. And that would be a disaster for the movie business, because then it wouldn't be the movies, it'd be TV.
Okay, that's a good point. I think that's it for this special show on the top 10 rental cassettes in the country right now. And next week, another special show in which Gene and I are going to talk about the special appeal of Clint Eastwood's Dirty Harry. The secret of Dirty Harry next week. And until then, we'll see you at the movies.
Pan-American, whether it's business or pleasure or a little bit of both, across the country and around the world, Pan Am, you can't beat the experience. Goober's freshly roasted peanuts dipped in delicious milk chocolate. Enjoy America's favorite movie time candy at home or at the movies. Raisinettes and snow caps too. Soft Sense Skin Lotion. When the summer sun, wind, and heat dry your skin, Soft Sense restores softness without stickiness.
The Philadelphia Experiment is a science fiction thriller about what might have happened to a World War II experiment to develop a machine that would make American battleships invisible to enemy radar. Apparently, the only basis in fact for this wild story is that there were such experiments done in Philadelphia in 1943. But what happens in this movie is so ridiculous and so silly, even as a movie, let alone real life, that we end up laughing at this picture more than either being thrilled or mystified by it. For example, here's the amazingly laughable scene featuring the hero, a young sailor from 1943 who has traveled in time warp to the present, to 1984, His battleship, his best friend, and an entire Nevada town are trapped in the same time warp, and Michael Paré, the actor, has been shot back up into the time warp like Buck Rogers to deactivate a power source on the battleship that will break the time warp and return everything to its rightful time and place.
Back in the ship.
But the hospital.
It's all over. You're gonna be all right now. I gotta go, buddy.
You're gonna go back?
I don't know. I just can't stay here.
Will I ever see you again?
One of these days. I promise you that.
That was Bobby DiCicco as Michael Paré's best friend there. There are at least a half dozen mistakes in this movie in terms of logic and people's reactions to situations. For example, when the ship disappears for the first time, no one gets excited and says, "Hey, we developed a way to make ships disappear. Let's try it on the Germans. The war will be over in a minute." The Philadelphia Experiment is an experiment itself in wrong-headed movie making. It's a thriller that one laughs at. And I'm Gene Siskel at the movies.